Maranatha's call, unity, renewal and healing, has always been close to my own heart. And although all three of those words are each worth an entire lecture, I've chosen tonight to concentrate on the damaged and wounded world in which we live and the need for healing, the third of those words, in our own lives, in our families, in our communities and in our nation. So in explaining the title of the lecture, I've used a phrase which appears in T.S. Eliot's Four Quartets, the second of which is called East Coca. East Coca is a village in Somerset. It's mentioned in the Domesday Book, and there's evidence there of Roman habitation. Eliot's ancestors came from the village, and his ashes were brought back there after his death in 1965. Eliot was an American who took British citizenship and went on to win the Nobel Prize for Poetry. He visited this city of his ancestors in 1940. Remember the date, 1940. It was a year, of course, into the Second World War. It was a year when war was raging throughout Europe, and it was against this fiery and chaotic background, and in this context of a nation facing catastrophe, that Eliot composed East Coca. The wounded surgeon plies the steel that questions the distempered part. Beneath the bleeding hands we feel the sharp compassion of the healer's art. The four quartets, Burnt Norton, East Coca, The Dry Salvages and Little Gidding, are the clearest and the richest exposition of Eliot's Christianity. And they move us beyond the spiritual desiccation and sense of defeat represented in his 1922 poem written after the First World War entitled The Waste Land. And deftly, the four quartets take the reader from chaos to renewal, from damage to healing, from despair to hope. The wounded, bleeding surgeon capable of treating the distempers and the afflictions visited upon us is Christ, the true physician. He is the wounded healer who applies the hard steel of the scalpel to cut away the infected and the gangrenous decaying tissue. Bloody and risky though it can be, exposing ourselves to this sharp compassion is the only way to new life and to new hope. East Coca, then, is a call to put ourselves trustingly into the surgeon's hands, into God's hands. Anyone who's undergone surgery will concur, and I had some surgery last year on my spine, that the decision to place yourself in the healer's hands requires careful deliberation and total trust. Of course, this is easier said than done in a world which encourages us to be autonomous and to believe that our destinies are in our own hands alone. A 12th century Welshman, Walter Mapp, understood that the hard sharpness of the surgeon's implements is a prerequisite in the accomplishment of healing. Dura est manus chirurgis et sanans. The hand of a surgeon is hard, but healing. That Eliot had the healing of a nation in mind, as well as each of us as individuals, is clear from the wartime context in which the poem was written. It contains profound insights into the human condition and the suffering from which none of us is immune. East Coca is a poem about agonized redemption. It was written in the same year that his contemporary, C.S. Lewis, composed The Problem of Pain. Like Eliot, Lewis too was trying to make sense of the troubling and the unsettling perennial question of how belief in a loving and omnipotent God may be reconciled with the existence of suffering. It was a problem which particularly disturbed my own father, who fought at El Alamein and Monte Cassino. He was a desert rat, and whose brother, an airman, was killed in 1942. How could God allow such terrible suffering? Temptation, of course, is always to blame God. I'm always struck by something that the chief rabbi, Jonathan Sacks, once said. He said, "Don't ask where was God at Auschwitz, ask where was man." But it isn't the question that many people ask. Why do some people die in car accidents and others not? Why does a child get abducted in Wales? while others do not? Why do some families face starvation, civil war, life as refugees, or become homeless, and others do not? Why were some of us among the tube passengers killed on July the 7th by terror in 2005 by terrorists, but others of us were not? Why Hitler? Why Stalin? Why Syria or Congo? Last week, I stood at the River Tumen, which is in northeast China. It is the border with North Korea, where escapees are shot dead by border guards if they try to cross the river. Many of them are Christians. Why them and not us? Why are Christians persecuted in Nigeria, in Sudan, and 60 other countries? But why not us? Why do terrible things happen to good people but not others? Straightforwardly, none of us know the answer to this why question. Our faith is simply incapable of giving us all the answers to these and other vexed questions. In St. Matthew's Gospel, we're told, he causes his sun to rise on the evil and the good, and sends rain on the righteous and the unrighteous. And no explanation is given as to why this is so. Our faith simply gives us the strength to live with the unanswered and unmediated questions which besiege us. Even if we did know the answers, our loved ones would still be sick or dead, others would be hungry or living in fear, and evil would still be stalking the world. It could be that we have been looking in the wrong places and asking the wrong questions. Discovering the healer and his art enables us to find peace about the questions which cannot be resolved, while questions like what, how, and who, as in what can I do to help, and how should I put my private faith into public action, and who is my brother and my sister, well, these will be questions that will deliver answers worth having. Now, it's against a questioning and doubting backdrop that Eliot writes the memorable stanzas of the Four Quartets, which was his last poem. East Coker encourages us to spend less time wrestling with the question why, and to place ourselves instead into the hands of the wounded surgeon who is bloodied and wounded so that we might experience healing. The powerful metaphor of Christ as the wounded surgeon is accompanied by the metaphor of the dying nurse, a phrase that Eliot uses. In the dying nurse, that phrase is used to describe a church which helps us to pass through birth, life, and death into Christ's promise of eternal life. Eliot understands that, words from the poem, time is no healer, a phrase we often say, oh, time is a great healer. Eliot says, no, time is no healer. The patient is no longer here. And he says that some questions are beyond answer. Against the loss and pain experienced by so many, Eliot tells us that in my beginning is my end. In my beginning, in the coming to new life, is my end. There is only the fight to recover what has been lost and found and lost again and again. J.R.R. Tolkien, for whom I have a great fondness and affection for his writings, Tolkien said that for him, he was a Christian from the Catholic tradition, he said for him as a Catholic, he said that history was one long defeat, but always with glimpses of the final victory. There is only the fight to recover what has been lost and found and lost again and again. Now, some of this may seem propitious, but the poem reflects that perhaps neither gain nor loss. For us, there is only the trying. The rest is not our business. So we don't need to answer the questions. There's only the trying. The rest is not our business. Eliot concludes East Coker with words drawn from the 14th century English mystic and the anchoress, Julian of Norwich, who at the age of 31, while suffering from a severe illness and believing she was on her deathbed, had a series of intense visions of Jesus. Eliot writes that despite the unanswered questions, and all shall be well, and all manner of things shall be well, when the tongues of flames are enfolded into the crown knot of fire, and the fire and the rose are one. East Coker was written at a time of utter uncertainty for this nation. It was composed as Winston Churchill was telling the House of Commons on June the 18th, 1940, that the battle for France is over. I expect that the Battle of Britain is about to begin. It was written as the German High Command announced that the British Army is encircling and our troops are proceeding to its annihilation. It was written as King George VI on May the 26th called the nation to prayer and repentance, following which Hitler ended his general advance. A storm of great fury engulfed the Luftwaffe, and as calm settled on the channel, some 335,000 men of the British Army were evacuated from Dunkirk. It was written as the German Air Force that summer would send 800 aircraft to begin their systematic and lethal bombardment of our cities. In preparing the nation for the battle which lay ahead, Churchill cast up what he called the dread balance sheet, words that appear in Hansard, the dread balance sheet. He was pulling no punches in carefully assessing the scale and the nature of the threat which had faced our country at the hands of the Nazis. Remember those words, the dread balance sheet, in terms of what I will say a little later on. What Churchill said at that time to the assembled parliamentarians in the House of Commons was, upon this battle depends the survival of Christian civilization. Upon it depends our British life and the long continuity of our institutions and our empire. The whole fury and might of the enemy must very soon be turned on us. Hitler knows that he'll have to break us in this island or lose the war. If we can stand up to him, all Europe may be freed and the life of the world may move forward into broad, sunlit uplands. But if we fail, then the whole world, including the United States, including all that we've known and cared for, will sink into the abyss of a new dark age made more sinister and perhaps more protracted by the lights of perverted science. Let us therefore brace ourselves to our duties and so bear ourselves that if the British Empire and its Commonwealth last for 1,000 years, men will still say this was their finest hour. Well, in every generation, new battles have to be fought, new enemies to be faced. In that poem written in that same year as that speech, Eliot wrote, "Houses live and die. There is a time for building and a time for living and for generation. Healing and renewal will go together." The challenges today may not be aerial bombardment, but what Churchill called the survival of Christian civilization, our British way of life, the freedoms and liberties which we cherish, must be defended in our own time and indeed in every time. In the debris of wrecked and ruined homes, of prematurely ended lives, of embattled and frightened communities, must come the same desire to move towards the sunlit uplands. And to do this, we'll need more than ever the sharp compassion of the healer's art. Only then shall we, in Mother Julian's phrase, see that all manner of things will be well. So much then for the inspiration behind the title of the lecture. What if, like Churchill, we were to examine the dread balance sheet of Britain today? In 1942, 2 years after Churchill's speech, 2 years after Eliot's poem, while we still were at war, Archbishop William Temple, then Archbishop of Canterbury, published his Christianity and Social Order. He insisted, in words that remain true today, the church must announce Christian principles and point out where the existing social order at any time is in conflict with them. It must then pass on to Christian citizens the task of reshaping the existing order in closer conformity to the principles. That is the same challenge that we face in our time that they faced in ours, in theirs. What would the dread balance sheet of 2012 look like? What would it look like if we carried out an evaluation today of life in our country? We would see a faithless society which has become an atomized, lonely, and often selfish society. A faithless society which has become a culturally diminished society. A faithless society which has become a fatherless society and a broken family society. What has been done in the name of freedom has created a world of CCTV cameras, high streets which have become no-go areas after dark, binge drinking and shelves full of antidepressants. How has this made us freer or happier? In 2006, a report by University College London stated that the UK has the worst problem with antisocial behaviour in Europe. It's increasingly felt like a world rapidly going to hell in a basket. Let's apply the children test in our dread balance sheet. A good place to start is, of course, with the plight of children. Dietrich Bonhoeffer once remarked that the test of the morality of a society is what it does for its children. The dread balance sheet would reveal that 750,000 British children have no contact with their fathers following the breakdown of relationships. 25% of our children live with one parent, not two, and 33% of those live below the poverty line. Many single parents struggle valiantly, and some very successfully, to bring up their children, but I doubt that many believe their situation is better than having two parents to shoulder that responsibility. Men particularly need to understand that you may be able to walk away from your girlfriend or to divorce your wife, but you can't divorce your children, and to them you have an unending responsibility. In 2002, the think tank Civitas, in a report entitled Experiments in Living the Fatherless Family, found that children being brought up without a father are more likely to live in poverty and deprivation, to have emotional and mental problems, to have trouble at school, to have trouble getting along with others, to have a higher risk of health problems, that they're more likely to run away from home and are likely to be at greater risk of suffering physical, emotional, or sexual abuse. Britain's dread balance sheet reveals that according to the Children's Society, 100,000 children run away from home each year. Save the Children say that 3.9 million children are living in poverty, and that a staggering 1.7 million children are living in severe, persistent poverty in the UK, which after all is one of the richest countries in the world. Every single day, 4,000 children call Childline. Since it was founded in 1986, it's counselled more than a million children. Before they are born, each day we abort 600 of our children, some up to birth if they have a disability or defect, such as cleft palate or Down syndrome. John Paul II once observed that a nation that kills its own children is a nation without hope. And he said a society will be judged on the basis of how it treats its weakest members, and amongst the most vulnerable are surely the unborn and the dying. It is a fact that 42 million unborn children are aborted every year, annually throughout the world. That's 115,000 every single day, 600 in Britain each day. And in the past 12 months, there have been over 189,000 abortions in the UK. The latest statistics reveal that taxpayers spend £118 million on abortions in the UK, of which £75 million went to private clinics. That of the nearly 7 million abortions, just 143 in all these years have been where a mother's life has been in danger. And that 48,000 people have had more than one abortion, some as many as eight. And here in the northwest of England, 24,933 people have had between 2 and 10 abortions. And consider three recent reports. The first concerns a group of so-called ethicists linked to Oxford University, who argue that newborn babies are not, quotes their words, actual persons, that they don't have, quotes, a moral right to life, and can legitimately be killed after they've been born. We would call it infanticide. They prefer the usual kind of euphemism, and in this case, the euphemism is afterbirth abortion. The child is then represented as a threat rather than as a blessing. The second report is the result of investigative journalism at its best, and it revealed how 9 British abortion clinics were willing to abort babies on the grounds of their gender. Now, this is something that we know happens in China, we know happens in India. The Economist magazine said that there are now 100 million missing girls in the world as a result of gendercide. But this has been going on in our own country too. The health secretary branded it as immoral and illegal. But the British medical journal Blog carried an article stating that sex selection abortions were justified on the grounds of choice. The blog asserted, and I quote, that health professionals and everyone is pro-choice on abortion should support pro-choice doctors and women seeking abortions, whatever their reasons, even when sex selection may be involved. And a group called Our Kingdom, which includes doctors, says sex selection abortion is not gender discrimination. Gender discrimination applies only to living people. Once more, there's a chilling logic. If it's just a question of my right to choose, me, my, I, rights, not duties, obligations or responsibilities, choice, not the consequences, if it's just that slogan against which we shape our values and our attitudes, then of course gendercide or abortion up to birth on disabled children, well, why worry about it? The mantra puts me at the center stage, not the needs of another, and it promotes rights, not duties, and it admires choice without looking at the consequences. Personal choice has eclipsed the sacredness or otherness of life itself. I find it profoundly disturbing, indeed shocking, to see the way in which opinion formers within the medical profession have ditched the traditional belief of the healer to care for two patients, the child and its mother, and to unfailingly uphold the sanctity of human life. Gender abortions are justified by this choice-driven, impoverished, and inhumane defense of child destruction. The third story concerns a court ruling that Catholic midwives in Scotland may not object on grounds of conscience to being required to supervise or assist staff involved in abortions. For me, forcing unwilling people to be complicit in the taking of innocent life smacks of neo-fascism, not intelligent or tolerant liberalism. All we need to comprehend about abortion can be found in the words of the fifth commandment. Apply those words to the eugenics used to kill 90% of babies with Down syndrome in the womb, 90% of whom are now hunted down and aborted before their births. Now we're seeing attempts to eliminate them and let them die rather than treat them in our NHS hospitals. Is this the same NHS we were celebrating at the Olympic Stadium? What a contrast, too, with the inspirational achievements of disabled athletes during the Paralympics, which were celebrated in the same stadium and have taught us so much about courage and the overcoming of seemingly impossible odds. As we rush pell-mell into Nietzschean-style eugenics and ethics, we should recall those inspirational moments, remembering that people with Down syndrome are human beings, not a, quote, drain on public finances. The disabled people would not be, quote, better off dead, but by allowing the elimination of the weak, it's we who expose ourselves as the truly weak. Remember the sharp compassion of the healer's art, not the surgeon's knife or hypodermic syringe used to hunt you down and kill you. Doctors should always be the defenders, not the destroyers of life. Viktor Frankl, in The Doctor and the Soul, said, "Sometimes the unfinished are among the most beautiful of symphonies." One in five of our children remains unfinished, not making it to birth. Many of those who do never experience the beauty or innocence of hope. Britain's dread balance sheet reveals that if you abuse and kill the child in the womb, you're unlikely to have much respect for the child after birth. Consider that 5 million images of child abuse are in circulation on the internet, featuring some 400,000 children. In Edinburgh, figures published in 2010 showed a 75% increase in the number of babies addicted to drugs because of their mother's addiction. Last year, Samaritans answered 4.6 million calls from people in despair. That's one call every 7 seconds. Samaritans say, quotes, "A conservative estimate is that there are 24,000 cases of attempted suicide by adolescents, that's 10 to 19 year olds, every year in England and Wales, which is one attempt every 20 minutes. As they grow up, suicide accounts for 20% of all deaths among young people aged 15 to 24. Britain's Dread balance sheet will reveal that more than 140,000 people attempt to commit suicide every year, but 29.4 million antidepressants were dispensed in one recent year, a 334% increase since 1985, at a cost to the National Health Service of £338 million. And that 7 million are now living alone in Great Britain, entirely unprecedented in our history. How are those things not in some way connected? 26% of our households comprise just one person, and on present trends, by 2016, 36% of all homes will be inhabited by a single person, a trend accelerated by family breakdown and phenomenal divorce rates, which are the highest in Europe. And this has led to huge pressures, you've heard them expressed here in Manchester this week at one of the political conferences, for additional accommodation. On the other hand, just putting people into accommodation by themselves and building more and more accommodation, not because of population increase, but because of breakdown. What does that conceal? It concedes brokenheartedness and it conceals toxic loneliness. How we treat the elderly is a pretty good test as well of how civilized our country is. Britain's Dread balance sheet reveals that our treatment of elderly people is fast becoming a national scandal, with an estimated 1 million elderly people not seeing a friend or a neighbour or a relative during the course of an average week. I was in China last week, a country which still shows respect for the elderly. Here, we talk endlessly about making it easier to kill the elderly by legalising euthanasia. Instead of the sharp compassion of the healer's art, many legislators now believe that a lethal injection would be preferable. A new bill to legalise assisted dying, another euphemism, is to come before Parliament. And just 2 weeks ago, the Liberal Democrats said that we should introduce Dutch and Belgian-style euthanasia laws. But friends, consider for a moment what this would mean. In Belgium, there are calls for euthanasia for prisoners, and it's reported that they have been harvesting organs from people who have been euthanized. In Holland, statistics indicate that the number of euthanasia deaths in 2011 in the Netherlands increased by 18% to 3,695. This follows increases of 13% in 2009 and 19% in 2010. In other words, the numbers of people being killed year in, year out has been rising exponentially. And furthermore, a quarter of those are done now without the patient's consent. A House of Lords inquiry in 2005 predicted that if these Dutch-style laws were introduced here, it would lead to 13,000 euthanasia deaths in Britain every year. The proposed new British law would use the framework and provisions, so its sponsors say, of the 1967 Abortion Act as a template, paving the way for exactly the same outcomes. Instead of approaching 7 million unborn children, it would be legions of disabled, sick and elderly people whose lives will be ended. The proposals will be disguised with words like compassion and dignity, mercy, but the reality will be doctors who will be required in future to kill patients. Disabled people will be made to believe that they'd be better off dead. Patient safety would be compromised, and politicians using the new law as a pretext will withdraw resources from the care of the sick. Far from providing dignity in dying, these proposals would sound the death knell for Britain's outstanding hospice movement and palliative care. To die with dignity, we don't need doctors to kill us. The so-called right to die would soon become a duty to die and to die quickly. This bill is to be based on the findings, we're told, of Lord Falconer's Commission on Assisting Dying. It was hopelessly biased and distorted. It was stacked full of euthanasia sympathisers and was established by a group called Dignity in Dying, which was formerly known as the Voluntary Euthanasia Society. The British Medical Association, the BMA, who oppose any change in the law, passed a 5-point resolution that undermined the Commission credibility by questioning its impartiality and its independence. The euthanasia lobby decided to set up their commission because when two genuinely independent parliamentary select committees carefully examined the issue, they came out against any change in the law. And indeed, when the votes were taken in the House of Lords, it resulted in large defeats for those proposals, 148 votes to 100, 191 votes to 141. The last attempt at legalisation in Scotland also resulted in a heavy defeat, 85 votes to 16. For the record, and to give some idea of the scale of the parliamentary inquiry, the Select Committee that examined this issue in great detail covered 246 Hansard columns and two volumes of 774 pages and 116 pages respectively. There were 15 oral sessions, 48 groups or individuals giving evidence, 88 witnesses giving written evidence, 2,460 questions were asked, and the committee received 14,000 letters. Compare the coverage given by the BBC and others to that parliamentary inquiry with the media circus and the feeding frenzy which has been generated around these proposals that are now being promoted. An unbiased and impartial account of that debate might mention the opposition to change in the law expressed in Parliament, predominantly on the grounds of public safety, and the opposition that's been expressed by the BMA, the Royal Colleges, the hospices, and notably the disability rights organisations, who eloquently set out all the negative outcomes which would result from a change in the law. There is a systematic propaganda campaign being orchestrated by the media aimed at changing the law, and for several years we've been treated to a barrage of propaganda. Even the BBC's Radio Times joined the pack, claiming on its cover that watching a man die in Switzerland would be, quotes, 5 minutes of television that would change our lives. The sub-editor who chose that caption perhaps failed to appreciate its irony, but the 5 minutes it took to change our lives irredeemably ended another's life. The BBC is in danger of becoming a mere cheerleader, producing 5 programmes, as it's done in the past 3 years, in favour of change, while signally failing to present the other side of the argument. But this isn't just about bias. The BBC's recent programmes celebrating suicide at the Dignitas Clinic in Switzerland not only breaks their own code about providing balance when discussing ethical issues, but even more seriously, they also breach the World Health Organization, WHO, guidelines published in 2000. The WHO clearly set out the responsibilities and duties of the media. Now, consider some of these strictures in the context of the programme featuring Terry Pratchett and the Euthanasia Centre in Switzerland. The WHO begin by reminding the media of the incredible impact which it can have in informing attitudes and behaviour, something that Lord Leveson has been looking at over these last months. The WHO said, "Media strongly influence community attitudes. Media can also play an active role in the prevention of suicide." The WHO points to the way in which television can negatively influence suicidal behaviour. One study showed an increase in the number of suicides for up to 10 days after television news reports of cases of suicide. They also warn against publicising suicide stories where celebrities are involved. And they warn against sensational coverage, which they argue should be assiduously avoided. The coverage should be minimised to the greatest possible extent possible, they say. And I believe they're right when they argue, quotes, "suicide is perhaps the most tragic way of ending one's life. The majority of people who consider suicide are ambivalent. They are not sure that they want to die. One of the many factors that may lead a vulnerable individual to suicide could be publicity about suicides in the media, how the media report on suicides can influence other suicides," end of quotes. A person's death then should not be a form of prime time entertainment, part of the battle for program ratings, dressed up in the name of hollow compassion. In this country, 550,000 people die every year. Very rarely do any make the newspapers or the media. Why does one lethal cocktail, but not 549,999,000 deaths, warrant wall-to-wall campaigning coverage? Macmillan nurses, hospices and palliative care give overwhelming love and support to the majority in Britain. They give them a dignified death which does not involve commissioning doctors and nurses as patient killers. By all means, agitate for improvement where the provision or practice isn't good enough, but let the BBC end this one-sided and relentless campaign and consider what is at stake. Chillingly, Baroness Warnock, who shaped the laws which have led to the destruction of millions of human embryos, has said that the sick are, quotes her words, wasting people's lives because of the care they require. Quotes, if you're demented, you're wasting people's lives, your family's lives, and you're wasting the resources of the National Health Service. Suggesting that we should have a duty to die, she said, I think that's the way the future will go. Putting it rather brutally, you'll be licensing people, i.e. doctors, to put others down. To put others down. This turns the argument into a worth based on someone's economic value rather than their true human value and their human dignity. Either we are each and every one of us made in the image and likeness of God, or we are not. And if we are, that places a duty on us as to the way we protect people in our society. Now, in case you think putting people down just couldn't happen here, consider again the situation in Holland. Just before Christmas, the Dutch announced that they're considering mobile units to kill people in their own homes. 1,000 of the 4,000 euthanasia deaths in Holland each year are now done without the patient's consent. And not content with this, the Dutch say that 80% of people with dementia or mental illness are being, quote, missed by the country's euthanasia laws. They say that this death on wheels mobile unit service is necessary because some GPs have refused to administer lethal drugs to their patients. And in March this year, euthanasia clinics launched 6 mobile euthanasia teams in the anticipation that they will achieve a further 1,000 deaths a year. These mobile death units are targeted at unmet need, including people with chronic depression, disabilities, Alzheimer's, loneliness, and those whose request to be killed has been refused by their doctors. It's as if the Dutch have forgotten the last time mobile death squads were deployed in Europe. This isn't giving people dignity in dying. Sending out mobile units to administer lethal injections to put people down will strike fear into the hearts of the vulnerable. It diminishes the dignity and humanity of the sick and elderly, and diminishes those of us who condone it. Imagine what will happen in Britain if the proposed laws, rubber stamped at a political conference in this country just 10 days ago, imagine what will happen if they're implemented. You have a terminal, incurable disease. You have the option of palliative care at a cost of around £1,000 a week, or a glass of barbiturates at £5. What will happen if we accept Lady Warnock's proposition that you're wasting the resources of the National Health Service? How many relatives would put an inheritance before a life? 1 in 8 current cases of elder abuse currently involves financial abuse by relatives, and it would inevitably increase if we change the law. And health ministers, counting their pennies in a recession, will be tempted to go for the cheaper option. One Conservative health minister has already announced her support for changes in the law. A bill allowing assisted suicide will carry the seeds of its own extension. If we allow it for some, why deny it to others? So how long before the Dutch mobile killing units arrive in a street near us? To imitate Holland is unnecessary, it is dangerous, and it is unethical. As the distinguished lawyer, my colleague Alex Carlyle, Lord Carlyle QC, puts it, we have a hard law, but with a kind face, and we should keep it that way. He says the real concern was and must remain public safety. The potential for collateral harm to the general majority of terminally ill people from giving a few individuals a right to prescription suicide pills, the so-called safeguards, were paper thin. And my colleague, Baroness Finlay of Llandaff, herself a professor of palliative care, says, we don't understand the difference between euthanasia and indefinitely continuing inappropriate treatment. Doctors, she says, regularly discontinue futile treatment, but they don't do it in order to end a patient's life. They're simply recognizing that death cannot be prevented by treatment. End-of-life decisions, which are made every day by doctors, aren't the same thing as ending-life decisions. When the physical, psychological, and spiritual needs of the patient are met, requests for euthanasia are actually extremely rare. Less than 1,000 people persistently ask for it. 95% of palliative medicine specialists are opposed to any change in the law. The Association of British Neurologists warned that severe depression will lead to cases of assisted dying, and that a law which says that two doctors can determine such cases will offer few safeguards. There'll be no requirement that either of the two doctors, exactly what we have with the abortion laws, just any old two doctors stamping forms and saying that they can go ahead, but they should have any knowledge of the patient concerned. The proposed law won't require them to have seen the patient's notes or even to have examined the patient. The whole casual process could take place over the telephone. There's no requirement that either of these doctors should have any expertise in or experience of the medical condition in question. And yet this is an essential prerequisite for determining the presence of a terminal illness and for giving a prognosis of its course. There are no arrangements for seeking an expert opinion in cases of doubt. What will happen, for instance, if a patient is suffering from cognitive impairment or their judgment is clouded by depression? To suggest that vulnerable people could be protected by two doctors being of their opinion in good faith is dangerously naive at best and deceptive at worst. Such a casual system of assessment is totally out of proportion with the gravity of the decision that is being taken. Proponents of change insist that public opinion favours such a change, but public opinion would reintroduce capital punishment too. And are we to suspend prudent judgment in that case too? Rather than imitating the Dutch, we need to get behind groups like the Admirable Care Not Killing Alliance to defend and care for the sick and the elderly, and to put our energy into extending compassionate palliative care and hospice provision and practical loving support. Let's demand dignity in living with the same fervour as those who want to license the routine killing of the most vulnerable in society. Recall too the story that when Mother Teresa was the guest of the White House at the National Prayer Breakfast, she described to then President Clinton and his guests how she'd visited a home for the elderly, where they had no shortage of material conveniences. But why, she asked, does everyone sit looking at the door? She received the reply, it's because they're looking for the relatives who never come to visit them and who have no time for them. Care and kill should never be used as synonyms, and they have no place in the healer's art. Let me say something about the loss of human dignity and corrupted values. If we have a scandalous concern for human dignity at the beginning and the end of life, Britain's dread balance sheet shows that the deficit is not much better when it comes to other vulnerable groups. 2,000 people are sleeping rough in England. The number increased by a fifth last year. 84,900 households, which may contain more than one person, are classified as homeless. The prison population has increased by 85% since 1993. With 87,673 men and women in our jails. Gun crime, as we're only too sadly aware, in Manchester, claims the lives of 30 people in the United Kingdom every day. The average lifespan for people who get involved in gun crime in this city is a mere 24 years, and one woman in every four will be the victim of violence in her own home during the course of her lifetime. Britain's dread balance sheet reveals that individuals now owe more in debt than the wealth generated by the entire country in a year. At the end of July 2012, total UK personal debt stood at a revised £1,410 trillion, up from £1,406 trillion at the end of July 2011. 331 people, the figure I understand rather better, 331 people every day of the year will be declared insolvent or bankrupt. That's equivalent to one person every single 60 seconds during a working day. Almost 30 of every 10,000 people living in the northwest of England are destined for insolvency. Britain's dread balance sheet reveals a society where too many people think they owe nothing to anyone except the pursuit of their own desires. And increasingly, this is reflected in our decision to opt out of our communal responsibilities. Aristotle, the father of our democracy, said that eidos, shame, would attach to the man who refused to play their part. Well, the Caravan Club and the Royal Society for the Protection of Birds have more members than all the United Kingdom's political parties combined. Just 1% of the population are members of a political party in the UK. We've come a long way, haven't we, since the Liberal, Conservative or Labour Club sat in the heart of every community. Trimden Labour Club, remember it? The scene of Tony Blair's Sedgefield triumphs, it closed a year ago. In 1951, the Conservative Party had 2.9 million members, Labour 876,000. Today they have 177,000 and 190,000 respectively. And the Liberal Democrats have seen a reduction of their membership by 30,000 to 66,000. And involvement in church life has also declined. Whilst almost 2 out of 3 still identify themselves as Christians, around 15%, 4 million people, go to church at least once a month. That's the 4th lowest attendance rate in Europe. Intriguingly, though, many still claim a personal relationship with God, but decline to make the effort to take part in church life. They believe without belonging, believe without participating. There's also been a decline in membership of trade unions from 13 million to 7 million a little over 30 years ago, and representative organisations such as women's leagues and mothers' unions, all of them experiencing significant falls. For a society to be healthy, we have to be participators and the trustees, not the owners of what we possess. Social, political, and economic activity must ultimately centre on the common good rather than individual acquisitiveness or the hegemony of the state. T.S. Eliot would have had our diminished and dehumanised society in mind when he suggested that we are living and partly living, while C.S. Lewis prophetically foresaw a society where we would see what he famously called the abolition of man. And how do we intend, then, to address the deficit on Britain's dread balance sheet? What can we learn from what's gone before? During the 18th century, not a good time for this country, men like John and Charles Wesley, their hearts warmed, as they said, by the Holy Spirit, stepped into the quagmire that Britain then was. Their new enthusiasm so alarmed the church authorities that church doors were literally barred against them. In the fields and at the makeshift venues, the re-evangelisation of England began. The Wesleys, George Whitfield and others deepened the religious renewal, followed in the 19th century by the Oxford movement of the Tractarians, and then by the Catholic Spring and Cardinals John Henry Newman and Cardinal Manning. The religious awakening was accompanied by a commensurate awakening of social virtue and working for the common good. And among the achievements of the Christian social reformers, such as William Wilberforce and Lord Shaftesbury, were the abolition of the slavery, the ending of child labour, public health legislation, ragged free schools, and significant social progress. A century later, in 1904, Joseph Jenkins led an extraordinary Welsh religious revival and brought 100,000 converts in a year. Many became the flag bearers for political and social activism. The chapel spearheaded reform and deterred revolution. Through these examples of religious and spiritual revival, we can trace personal renewal and then national reconstruction. We can also see the path we now need to take. Having understood the dread balance sheet and analysed the root causes, we then need to commit ourselves to act. Be clear, friends. A nation or state will not survive for long if its communities and civil structures are decaying, or if its rulers don't pursue civic virtue. A society where individual autonomy and individual choice become trump cards in every game live dangerously close to the edge. A respect for law, a sense of personal responsibility, public spirit and munificence, firmness of purpose, discernment and foresight, perseverance and a sense of duty might be chief among the civic qualities to which we should aspire, and our gifts must be used for the common good. It's self-evident that our society has become increasingly uncivil as modern citizenship has revolved around the flaccid language of rights alone, and with a weakened sense of ethics and a lack of virtue, and with no shared framework for reaching conclusions because there are so few shared values. We've created a dehumanized society where we breed unrealizable demands, a cult of selfishness and materialism. The Jewish sage Hillel said, "If I'm not for myself, who will be? But if I'm only for myself, what am I?" And what will be the fate of those who are only for themselves? Eliot puts it like this in East Coker: "Oh, dark, dark, they all go into the dark, the vacant interstellar spaces, the vacant into the vacant, the captain, merchant bankers, eminent men of letters, the generous patrons of art, the statesmen and the rulers, distinguished civil servants, chairmen of many committees, industrial lords and petty contractors, all go into the dark, and we all go with them into the silent funeral." Does it have to be like this? When Europe was facing the challenge of Nazism, the Protestant theologian Dietrich Bonhoeffer prophetically wrote, "The most important question for the future is how we can find a basis for human life together, what spiritual laws we accept as the foundation of a meaningful human life." And to meet the challenge, Bonhoeffer argued that we each have a duty to take a stand. "We have been the silent witnesses of evil deeds," he said. "What we shall need is not geniuses or cynics or misanthropes or clever tacticians, but plain, honest, straightforward men." Bonhoeffer also warned that silence in the face of evil is evil itself. Silence in the face of evil is evil itself. While Dr. Martin Luther King said, "Our lives begin to end the day we become silent about the things that matter." Our lives begin to end the day we become silent about the things that matter. In every sphere of life today, then, we need plain, honest, straightforward men and women willing to speak up about the condition of our nation. Like Bonhoeffer, St. Edith Stein died at the hands of the Nazis. A German Jewish philosopher who became a Catholic nun, she died in the gas chamber at Auschwitz. At a time when the Nazi state was stifling dissent and corralling its citizens into conformism with the tenets of National Socialism, Stein wrote tellingly about the responsibilities of every citizen to be an agent for good or ill, and about the way in which the values of the individual citizen determine the nature of the state in which they live. Both society and the state consist entirely of persons. These aren't mysterious entities made up of men, women, and children whose strengths and weaknesses, talents and needs are all too real. She said, "The state is not an abstract entity. It acts and suffers only as those individual agents through whose actions the functions of the state are discharged, act and suffer. Moral predicates apply to the state only insofar as they apply to the relevant individuals." The state then takes its inspiration from the values of its citizens. If Britain is to be remade, it will require a huge effort to persuade every citizen to take seriously the promotion of the common good. Out of the present malaise and crisis is an opportunity to proclaim a belief in human dignity, the worth of each life, the duty we have to the communities of which we're a part, and a call for an outpouring for the common good. The Chinese calligraphy for the word crisis can also be used for the word opportunity. Dire situations can be turned around. Winston Churchill wept when he saw the destruction of the East End of London by Nazi bombardment in those 1940s. He understood the importance of drawing a whole nation around a common cause. "All the great things are simple," he said, "and many can be expressed in a single word: freedom, justice, honour, duty, mercy, hope." Today, our nation faces a new common enemy and a new peril. It's both external and internal, but it can also become a common cause. And one of the best weapons we have remains Churchill's belief in those single words which we in Great Britain cherish: freedom, justice, honour, duty, mercy, hope. Britain urgently needs then to feel the sharp compassion of the healer's art and think what our country would be like if healing became a central mission of the church in every family, in every neighbourhood, and across the nation. In the Four Quartets, Eliot tells us that the only hope or else despair lies in the choice of pyre to be redeemed from fire by fire. He's referring to the Holy Spirit and to the dove descending breaks the air with flames of incandescent terror, of which the tongues declare the one discharges from sin and error. Love is the unfamiliar name behind the hands that wove the intolerable shirt of flame which human power cannot remove. We only live, only suspire, consumed by either fire or fire. Touched then by the sharp compassion of the healer's art, our hearts can be repaired, and as we are healed, we may then heal our families, our communities, and our nations. There's no other way, and our task must surely be to persuade our fellow citizens to join us in seeking the balm of the wounded healer. Thank you for listening.